Welcome back, Dota 2 fans. It's our second and final best of three of the day. Game 2. Flipside Tactics facing up against the Broodmothers. And Flipside able to take a game 1 with a Huskar pick. I'm not going to say off the back of a Huskar pick, but with a Huskar pick. So sorry for the extended break, guys. Had a few people missing to get this one underway. But either way, MRP, Mike Lores here. Game on Invitational Semifinals. Game 2 here. Between Flipside and Broodmothers.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if Flipside go back to their kind of trademarked aggressive style, most of that being centered around that Dragon Knight, who was like the frontliner, as you would ordinarily expect, but also the Nature's Prophet play from the Flipside last game really coming together, setting up some rather early ganks, perhaps surprisingly early for Broodmothers, as Nature's Prophet will always have the option of being in all places at once. Doesn't mean he has to go all places at once. But yeah, Broodmothers kind of have to prepare for it. I don't think I've seen Flipside Tactics, at least not in a very long time, go for a little bit more of a slower, patient kind of like anti-mage style play like we saw in that first set today. So you should expect the aggression. And I mean, they handled it pretty well, but it just takes one slip up and suddenly you lose the game. So for Broodmothers, it's probably, it can be Beastmaster pick. As I said, you don't want to give that to Flipside. That's the worst thing you could possibly do. Mm.
And any CIS team, really, for that matter. And in general, just a very strong hero. We see a Darkseer Disruptor first phase set of bans coming out from Flipside side. So I guess they were watching the previous set today. But going to remove those heroes from the pool regardless. And leave in the Beastmaster for the Broodmother side. Shachlo, likely going to have his Doom here since the Phoenix has been picked up. And there would be a little bit disabled light. If this ends up being the support duo. But a couple of tanky cores that... one tanky core in the front lines. The Sunray behind him. Always going to be nice to keep him healed up as well. A lot of control offered, though, from the Radiant side. And both of these heroes are very burstable inside that Primal Roar. Big, long, single target disable. Especially with the Mana Burn comes out for the Doom as well. He can't even turn and get a Doom off if you get an early set of Necro Books up. For the Radiant side. So I really like this opening from Broodmothers, even more so than I did in the first game. And I feel like they're definitely postured up here to be aggressive in the lanes, take an advantage, and maybe snowball through that mid game.
Also have to keep their eyes open for these like Earth Spirit, Bounty Hunter type picks for maybe Flipside Tactics that they want to pick up. But Bane is also going to make the Life Stealer a hell of a lot worse. And maybe because Flipside Tactics aren't going to want to pick it, they will have to ban it. The Broodmothers, if they get their hands on that one with the attack speed from the Beastmaster, with the cover from the Bane, and going into a tanky hero like Doom, it seems like it's playtime for the Lifestealer there. So wouldn't be surprised to see that one banned out from Flipside. Although, Doom Phoenix into a Dragon Knight, I wouldn't be surprised to see that from Flipside either, honestly. Now I would be surprised to see it. So it's going to be banned out by Broodmothers. But how are Flipside actually going to kill these structures? Because that's really what you always have to look for Flipside. They need someone to facilitate that push. And it's probably going to be difficult to get these really big single target BKB-ish cores to be working up against the Grip and the Roar.
Yeah, both of those things going to deter Flipside from looking for something like a Death Prophet, who is very burstable under those two ultimates. And just look for some damage to come out from the Broodmother side hereafter. They have more than enough control, it feels, at this point. Someone perhaps to deal with the Supernova as well. The Lifestealer could be good on their side, in their hands, and maybe that's why we haven't seen it being removed from the pool. And could be something Flipside is contemplating here, as the Beastmaster is a decent vessel if he picks up a Boots of Travel for that Lifestealer to come through, and they deal very well against the Lifestealer, so more than likely they will leave it in the pool. Lifestealer can deal well with that. Weaver is another hero that really benefits from all this control, can kind of have free reign in the fights, and then Geminate is nice against the Supernova. They're going to remove the Alchemist for now. I'll take that away from Flipside Tactics. And I mean, Alchemist in general, a hero that often can see some attention in the second phase, but I don't feel like it's necessarily parallel with Flipside's general play style. I feel like they're certainly more, we're going to take the map over around the 12 to 15 minute mark, try and take all your tier ones, invade your jungle, and look to snowball from there, kind of choke you out of the map, strangulate you, and look to press their advantage at the high ground 20 to 25 minute mark. So I don't know, I do know they can play the Alchemist, but I don't know really that that's the direction they were heading. Either way, they're going to end up for the Void. So the Void Phoenix combo, once again, they're going to be assembled here for Vanskor's side.
It does seem like this draft from Flipside is going to be at least a little bit slower than last game. Getting that Faceless Void towards the offlane is situationally very, very useful with that Chronosphere, but is not going to offer that consistency that the Nature's Prophet does. So maybe Flipside switching things up a little bit. I think the big thing about Alchemist, as opposed to some other heroes that Flipside like to pick up, i.e. DK, is that Alchemist, which will take a long time before he can do anything in lane specifically, they really do like setting up those kills around that area. And I wouldn't be surprised to see Doom very heavily roam into that mid lane, depending on who the Broodmother's mid laner is going to be, of course. But you would expect Flipside to try to make some space to get crazy, Tame My Wild, that amount of farm. That's, you know, usually that's the goal for Flipside tactics. Tame My Wild is usually going to be that that real solid carry. It's like a mid lane kind of Arteezy kind of thing. Or, I guess, yeah.
They are going to need some damage to come out from that position, no doubt. A lot of these heroes offer control, they offer sustain, and they offer big teamfight ultimates, but neither of them really output all that much. And it seems like something that both sides are lacking to this point. But Earth Spirit going to be picked up right now. They're going to secure their mid lane even more so. Bane, Earth Spirit, very scary roaming duo. Bane, a good enough zoning support with good movement speed, good right click animation, and of course the brain sap to trade effectively with offlaners. So you can kind of leave the Earth Spirit to do his thing in the early game, disrupt the mid lane, maybe even rotate over to the opposite off lane as well and help out his Beastmaster. This is going to secure that the Beastmaster's in the 3-wall whether he jungles or not, so it's not going to be that 4-position greedy Beastmaster. I was looking at the possibility of that and picking up something like a Bristleback on the front lines to be a little bit resistant to the Chronosphere, but Sunray on the other side, pure damage, going to be pretty good up against that, and more traditional support duo here going to be assembled by the Broodmother side. Still lacking a bit of damage, but have two positions in the mid and the safe lane that can pack tons of that going forward.
Yeah, you really want to get your lanes in an advantageous position here for Broodmother. Someone who can help in the Earth Spirit versus Tame My Wild is, of course, going to be as useful as possible. Even with the Bounty Hunter last game, contributions being not huge, adequate enough, but Earth Spirit, let's see if he can get a little bit more luck on his side in those rotations, as Flipside are going to go ahead and grab that Death Prophet. We've seen this earlier today, almost the exact same. No Doom, I think, but either way, Death Prophet, Faceless Void, and Phoenix, those are some heavy-hitting ultimates. And for Broodmothers, they almost have to get the initiation off before the Exorcism comes out, because if they fail to do so, if the Chronosphere comes out, they will just get torn to shreds. Yule Scepter on Death Prophet specifically going to make it hard for them to deal with that hero. So they have a pretty solid set of combos to combo in with that Chronosphere. And Broodmothers therefore have to worry about picking up too many melee heroes. Only have two for right now, but picking up more is going to be a little bit dangerous.
To the Chronosphere, no doubt. Bane also, without an Aetherlands, can be, you know, caught on the periphery of that if he's in the team fight looking to find a key grip. But it is a bit of a scary Death Prophet for game for me. I mean, there's a lot of control to deal with the DP, and, you know, two spells of which are pretty, like, not all that cooldown reliant. Like, the 85 seconds on the Prime Aurora, it'll be up very often. Yule Scepter doesn't really help you against that. May help you against the grip from the Earth Spirit, but feels like the Death Prophet is burstable here pending these last couple of cores. And you know, a couple cores resistant to the Chronosphere, and looking at the potentially the Slark to come out from the Broodmother side, can be able to kind of kite away the Death Prophet as well, get out of the range of that Exorcism, can look to frontline with the Shadow Dance and try and bring down the Phoenix Eggs. I think Weaver's a little less attractive than it was early on in the draft with the Void out, but actually going to go for the core Mirana here. So another hero that can buff up her units move speed, they can get off the invisibility in the fights, throws an arrow into the Chronosphere to kind of toss a wrench into those plans. And, you know, Bane Mirana, good old combinations. If you look up dual lanes in Dota 2, that'll be right up near the top.
Mid lane Mirana, I'm not sure if I'm generally a big fan of this. Like, you're out damaged by Death Prophet. With Bane, if you're in a side lane, you'll be pretty happy, but is that really what Broodmothers want to be doing right now? I mean, if you land a big arrow on a Faceless Void, you'll be able to kill him off. But if it's not quite long enough, you might just not have enough right-click damage for that. So I'm not really a huge fan of Moran here, honestly, for Brood Mothers. It seems like it is a little bit, it relies a little bit too much on getting kills early on. If those don't happen, if Flipside are able to dodge those kills or even kill the Morana a couple of times, then the hero is just absolutely garbage and can't really do all that much as far as killing off a Death Prophet or making sure the Chronosphere is mitigated. It just seems like the impacts of this hero are incredibly risky. But I mean, if you're going to pick up Morana, might as well be with the Bane. So we'll see what Brewmothers are going to grab for their real mid lane selection here, as seems like dual lanes for Broodmothers are a little bit more optimal here. Their versus Death Prophet matchup is really not fun for many heroes. Obviously, you want range, someone who can help out with the Earth Spirit. Maybe just put in a Quap. Oh, Wraith King. It's a mid Morana? Mid Wraith King?
Probably a mid Morana. I think there's an off chance we see a mid Bane as well with the Morana roaming in as he can set up the Nightmares, but scales a lot worse than the Morana, so more than likely we'll see the mid Morana here. I guess the Beastmaster or the Wraith King could go there, but I don't think either has enough to sustain to stand against the Spirit Siphon. So I think the most likely choice is the one who has the leap away to get away from that Spirit Siphon. And yeah, Wraith King is going to be nice in the sense that he's just resistant to the Chronosphere. If you drop it on him and expend that and only get a cooldown out of it, they can turn and look to make the fight. He's not a great Doom target as well. So in that sense, kind of can just frontline and look to waste out these cooldowns from Flipside. But Flipside just have such good team fight that, you know, even if the Wraith King soaks up some of these ultimates, there's definite potential for a scenario where everyone else is just dead on Broodmother's side. But it's an interesting fifth pick. I definitely agree. I would have rather have seen a better mid laner in general than the Morana. And I think maybe Broodmother's intention was to put the Morana in the safe lane, but for now, Focus is going to pick up the Wraith King, so he did play that Axe mid lane. I'm not sure if they're looking for another mid lane melee matchup, but I definitely feel like this one is even less statured to do well than the Axe versus DK of game one.
You don't really want to be a melee hero versus Death Prophet, because you have to disengage away from that siphon somehow, and Wraith King has no way to do it other than stun and walk away, and stun is pretty darn expensive. So Flipside's last pick, though, it's going to be that Gyrocopter. As far as, carries to pick up, it is kind of more so on the early game aggressive side of things. And it's going to, of course, add another bit of teamfight component into their Chronosphere bubble and already existing, very large amount of teamfight. Gyrocopter is the type of hero, though, who you can pretty easily kill.
Yeah.
If you're a Morana with a Bane setup, or, if you're a Beastmaster with Necro Books, the hero is fragile and will need a little bit of help. So offensively, Flipside don't really have a great setup for this Gyrocopter. The targets aren't really that appealing, and his help isn't really that appealing either. There's no Telekinesis or Magic Missile or really any play stun coming out from their draft, so it seems like this Gyrocopter is going to have to be forced to play a little bit of a slower, more passive kind of farming game in lane as opposed to always gunning for those kills.
Yeah, definitely so, and I feel like, for the most part, Vision will be at paramount for both these sides. I think because of the lack of defensive supports, just the sustain from the Sunray really available, and potentially a mechanism at some point from the Doom or the Phoenix, I feel like Flipside's Death Prophet is pretty darn susceptible if they don't hit a great Chronosphere. And in that sense, I feel like if Broodmothers can get the Vision up to silence up this Void or initiate with a Roar or a grip on the Death Prophet, things can go well for them here, certainly. I do feel like Flipside in general on paper have superior team fight, but I think the team with the initiation should more than often be the one taking the favorable engagement. So we'll see what ends up happening. We'll see how the lanes shake down here. The Earth Spirit could be that trump factor early on. Vanskor is on the Doom with the boots first once again, but didn't seem all that influential in the first game. Kind of was just stagnant in the offlane with the Darkseer. Didn't make all that many rotations. And since he has a Death Prophet versus a potentially melee matchup in this mid lane, he can definitely get some work done if he rotates in towards that. But for now, the Morana is the one pooled the Tango. So even though they've swapped players, I feel like this Morana still will be going towards that mid lane.
Mirana's kind of difficult to gank as Doom. You can still run her down if you have already softened her up with a couple right clicks and a crypt swarm. With the Scorched Earth movement speed, that is a possibility, but not one that Bangskore is really going to be super excited to explore. Relax is actually going to roll in. Smack Bangskore, and that's about it. That was kind of an awkward rolling boulder there from the Earth Spirit. Not really sure what that was about, but either way, it is going to be a dual lane that should be very easy, actually, for the Beastmaster. A lot easier than normal, at least nowadays. Sunray is great and everything. Gyrocopter has a lot of damage if the Beastmaster is alone, but no crowd control effects here. So it is going to have to be the Doom to facilitate those ganks if anything happens at all. And Doom is, I guess to his credit, going to find the one creep that is going to enable that in the Mudgolem. Pearl Boulder does a lot of damage. Plus, a little bit of Stun Duration may give the Gyrocopter enough to keep up with the Beastmaster, already going to fire off with those rockets. Boar's going to scout out Bangskore. Sunray's already there. Boulder is going to keep him in that Sunray, rolling from Relax. And the right click from Beastmaster's not quite going to be enough just yet. Gyrocopter doesn't have enough. Not through the Ring of Protection and the Stout Shield. They'll try for the Beastmaster, but he will survive, albeit barely.
Timely arrival of the creep wave there in order to save him. And you kind of mentioned the ease of this lane, or relative to lanes that are often assembled as of recent times, and I feel like Shotshell are going to have an even easier time bottom lane. They really don't have all that much kill potential unless he steps a little bit too far forward. Sure, in the early levels, we'll be able to zone him quite effectively, but thereafter, Wraith Fire Blast into the, you know, Nightmare, Wraith Fire Blast, Brain Sap, unless they get two very big crits coming out from the Wraith King, it's unlikely to kill him off. So I feel like Shotshell should be able to find his levels relatively easily. You mentioned how hard this Mirana is to gank. We'll be able to leap away after that boulder toss and salve up as well, return back into lane. Now the roll is going to look to find Vanskor, but Relax, we'll be short of doing so. So everything going to stagnate for the time being and see how the lanes end up working out. The Earth Spirit thus far hasn't really found many openings for Relax, and we'll look to stick around in this mid lane and find Tame My Wild. We'll at least secure this top lane rune, and it's going to be on the Illusion, which isn't going to give him all that much kill power here, but either way. I mean, who really benefits more from this early game kind of stagnant farming scenario? It feels like Flipside, once they get their ultimates, get really powerful, whereas the Mirana, the Wraith King, may need a bit more from the Radiant side.
I mean, they're both teams get a lot stronger once they get their ultimates, just kind of in a different fashion. So I'm not really sure if anyone is going to have a clear-cut advantage off of passive stage. They're going to try to go for Tame My Wild, will fail with the Siphon, keeping the Death Prophet safe. But yeah, Broodmothers will definitely rather be aggressive with this Bane compared to Flipside, where Phoenix doesn't really want to be getting into too many fights, especially fights where he's just wasting all his spells up against a Beastmaster. You really want to be using the early game power of Bane Wraith King as much as you can. So I think it is slightly better, if at all, for Flipside to be avoiding these confrontations, especially on this bottom lane. But the advantage is slim, if any, is there at all. Shotshell right now is pretty comfortably farming this bottom lane. He's picked up the 2 points in time lock, able to trade rather effectively with the Wraith King, and as you said, is rather kill proof. Unless Relax comes in, level 2 Relax comes in. Level 1 Earth Spirit, not as much so. They're going to stun up Bangskore, roll in towards him as well. He's got Scorched Earth, he's going to put it up. The Brain Sap, the Wraith Fire Blast, and still not enough damage. He will turn around, try to focus down. Focus, they'll grab the kill with the Void. And now Bangskore is in the trees. I think he's fine. Shotch, though, beating down hard. He's going to grab First Blood already, and now looking to block out Relax from rolling in towards Bangskore, looking for that bash. Never lucky, though. He's going to jump ahead of him. Still no bash. Shockwave is there. They bash him out of the rolling boulder, though. Oh, that's a big one. The Doom is going to have his clarity canceled, but Shotshell is just running amok right now. No one's able to stop him. There's so much damage being done by this Void, yet so few bashes. I've seen one, now two. Not really the bashes in a timely fashion, but still, it's first blood for Flipside.
Yeah, I mean, kind of a wise decision for Broodmothers to bypass Shotshell's Void there, but he just really understanding the laning situation, the matchup that he has, going for that second point in the bash. No need for the time dilation here, really. They don't have all that much kill potential on him as long as he holds his time walk. And he'll just stand, man up, and find a big kill on the solo safe laner there, or on the safe laner from Broodmothers. In the meantime, you know, Vanskar's been able to rotate around, find his levels. The Phoenix has found level 3 in the top lane, being the only solo support there and being able to take advantage of the jungle. So I feel like Flipside are fairly happy with this early game early on. Their Death Prophet is winning mid lane as you would expect her to. 22-8 to the 15-7 of her counterpart in the Mirana. And, you know, the story of the early game is just that Shotslow on this Void has far too much. The Beastmaster, though, he is holding his own, sitting at level 4.5 at about parity with the Void. Doesn't have a kill involvement, of course, but has not died. Picked up 11 CS, which is admirable considering his situation. And they are going to scout Vanskor here. May just be able to find an easy kill onto this Doombringer. The roll forward will slow him up, but that nerf to the duration may just be enough that he needs to get away. And the Beastmaster will not be able to rotate in with a summon to slow him further. So Vanskor going to be able to walk away on this Doom. Getting on level 3 mid lane, they're going to go in with the Spirit Siphon. Leap out. We'll keep the Mirana safe. Now the roll will find Tame My Wild. Oh, but he kicks him away from the arrow, in fact. Now the Exorcism is going to be popped up. Relax, taking a lot of damage. But Tame My Wild underneath the tower needs to be careful. The Hadouken once again is going to come in for a kill. But the Brain Sap from the high ground kills off the Death Prophet. And she utilizes most or very little of that Exorcism duration early on. So it's going to be a pretty painful loss for cost side for flip side in the mid lane.
It's going to be reasonable at the end of it. They force Mirana out the Doom. They get the kill on the Death Prophet. Doom gets some experience there as well, so it's not all bad. But for sure, the Broodmother side, not all on the same page. That initiation up towards bottom lane, they're going to help out. Focus, getting aggressed upon by Shot, so he's going to time walk forward. Still looking for those bashes. Vanskor doesn't have anything useful to help out here, except for the recovery afterwards with the regen aura. But Focus is having some difficulties keeping the Faceless Void at bay. Now the Faceless Void's got that Chronosphere. Tame Wild maybe going a little bit too aggressively over in the mid lane, just slightly, but so close to killing off that Mirana. If you get that, you are feeling real good as the Death Prophet. Gonna run to the Bane, though. Nightmare Arrow setup is a threat, but the Nightmare range, only level 2, is not that spectacular. So looks like Bane will leave the bottom lane Wraith King alone. I mean, kind of with Relax, but yeah, this kill lane on the bottom lane for Broodmothers is not going to get that much stronger with the Earth Spirit here. It's, in fact, probably going to get weaker.
Yeah, definitely so. Now Shotslow has the Chronosphere available. Can just, at the very worst, look to use that to counter-initiate. Metrum, top lane, is making his way over to that Supernova slowly and is relatively close to the Bane, who's sitting at level 5. But this Earth Spirit for Relax, one kill involvement, one death, sitting on barely level 3 at this point. 7 minutes into the game is a bit of a concern for Broodmother's side. And with Focus going down once as well, it does feel like Flipside with this second Exorcism may be able to get a lot more work done than with the first. They will Chronosphere bottom lane. Rocket Barrage is there. Sadoi rotating through. He's got the call down as well. And will drop it off. They'll kill off the Wraith King one time. He's going to be pincered into three heroes here, but they can continue to press forward. It is a big cooldown at this point in the game, so they will be able to make another attempt at his life with that Chronosphere before it comes off of cooldown. But the first rotation from Sadoi essentially nets just the reincarnation cooldown. No tower, no kill going the way of Flipside. Their Exorcism, though, is going to be up and off of cooldown. Speaking of which, though, he's going to be roared up by S2. The arrow going to come through as well. Tame My Wild likely to drop here. One last right click will finish him off. They're going to look to reinforce, though, with the Sunray. Metrum, he's a little bit out of position here. Starfall is not there because of the mana. Fire Spirits will slow up the Mirana, but he essentially trades his life now for the Earth Spirit. Vanskor going to come through. Does have the Infernal Blade to cancel the grip, and for that reason, Sadoi will dodge the arrow. Vanskor essentially saving his Gyrocopter, but they are unable to turn. So 2-for-1 in the mid lane, going the way of Broodmothers, and they're continuing to weather this storm early on, where Flipside are strong. The Mirana kind of being the turning factor in a lot of this. There's so much setup for her arrows, and she's 2-0-1 currently, looking to pick up that level 8 soon. So coming out of the mid lane with a fairly solid advantage over a difficult lane. Shotslow bot lane is going to catch a couple of crits, will time walk them out. Ill going to rotate through, no grip available though, so doesn't feel like there's much kill potential on this Void. Maybe on the other way around, though. Vanskor rotating through. He's only level 4, looking to pick up his level 5 soon. Will be nightmared up. Mirana going to TP in. Arrow comes through. Will be a 5-second on Vanskor. He's more than dead here. Sunray, not enough to heal him up. Metrum, the Valiant attempt, will not be able to save his Doom and won't be able to contribute to this Chronosphere for the next little bit as well, but Ashe still come up about simultaneously, and Sadoi returning to that top lane. This last little sequence of events have definitely benefited Broodmothers pretty heavily, with Sadoi rotating, finding nothing, the Death Prophet dying, Relax getting a little bit of time top lane as well. Rocket Barrage will come out, he'll silence up, the Gyrocopter will be able to roll up to the north, Relax able to make it out, call down used, Exorcism gonna be used mid lane, will net a tower here. Can they get anything further? Shockwave gonna come through, just force the Mirana back, and will be a tier one for an Exorcism.
Alright, so now that all that is said, Mirana's stuck in a corner with no leash. She's gonna Moonlight Shadow up the Sentry gear, and well, if they even need it, they'll Crypt Swarm her and Chronosphere her. Phoenix is awkwardly in the trees, but has a dive out, so should be fine. Roar is there, though. Phoenix is just not gonna make that play, and is gonna get punished. Well, for sure, you saw the Moonlight Shadow, don't know who's around the corner. You get out of there ASAP, so Phoenix kind of being careless there. I was gonna say, like, the rotation from Sidoi, not that bad, considering the Phoenix was on top lane, but the Phoenix didn't stay up there for long. They kind of trickled in towards that mid lane, kind of just fed themselves over one at a time towards the Broodmother squad. And flip side, team fighting is what they want to be doing, more so than Broodmothers, that's for sure. But that really wasn't a team fight. That was a whole bunch of like 3v1s, and for Broodmothers, that's the dream scenario. They're almost exclusively single target focused.
Yeah.
So if there's only ever one threat in the area, you're going to be able to handle that rather well. Now they're looking at the Faceless Void. He already uses Chronosphere, so there's a grip here. Just by getting that, should get a kill, although the supports are coming in. Shotch, though, is going to get gripped up before the time walk can happen. TP's coming in, that's Death Drop. Phoenix is here with Fangstorm, it's a little bit too late. They're going to get this call down here with the slowdown onto Focus with the Spirit Sight, and they'll grab two kills simultaneously. Two for one, as the Bane is going to get chased down. Icarus dive forward with the Fire Spirits. I think the Phoenix can get this kill by himself, but he's going to get some help. Bane going to try to go for the self-deny. Won't happen. Double kill for the Phoenix. Definitely redeeming his earlier misstep over in mid. Flip side, lose the Faceless Void, but make a big showing with their Gyrocopter.
Yeah, they will finally find the trade, and as you mentioned, the Gyro doing the bulk of the damage there, and with that call down coming through, they save the Exorcism as well, so can look to pressure this bottom lane, can look to defend top. Shotchel will TP there, he'll have his Chronosphere up in 20 seconds, and flip side starting to claw their way back in this early game at the very least. They will bring down the Wraith King before his level 1 reincarnation comes up there, bottom lane, and it is now available for Focus to return to the bottom lane. He did have some free space in the meantime and is still sitting atop the net worth chart, so not the worst set of events, or not the worst early game altogether for Broodmothers, but the last couple of circumstances certainly have benefited Flipside. We'll see if they're able to transition this anymore. They have Chronosphere Exorcism combo now, and they are looking to convene as quite a few heroes bottom lane. Focus, not the easiest target to focus down though, and bottom lane is shoved up pretty far, so BM are privy to the fact that there are a lot of people from Flipside missing off of the map.
Top. Shotchlo is deep in the trees, but spotted by the Beastmaster. He can chop his way through with the Wild Axes if they even need to. He'll actually do it now with the Starstorm coming in. Shotchlo scouted out and brought down. Silence is good onto Relax, but the disengage with the Moonlight Shadow, is that going to be good enough? There's no detection here on anyone. So yes, it will be good enough. Gotta carry Dust, Sentries. Faceless Void had a Sentry, but was perma-stunned the entire time. So Broodmothers get another free kill here. Flipside spend a lot of time on bottom lane looking for kills that will never happen.
Yeah.
And end up losing their Void for the second time now. Void is looking like he's going to rush the Blink Dagger, which is nice and everything, but you're not really finding the time to farm.
Yeah. It feels like Flipside look a lot like they did in game one, with kind of predictable movement as five. They're bot lane and they see a Wraith King in lane, and sure, he's difficult to kill, but when they're engaging four into your Chrono, or into your Faceless Void, and he's unlikely to get a Chronosphere off to turn when he takes a 5-second arrow to the face, it's probably, it's probably a more likely a win scenario if they go for the Wraith King and actually are able to kill him twice, because thereafter they would have the Exorcism to push quicker than Broodmothers did. But they wanted to ensure their tier 1 top lane, so they go to reinforce that and are able to do so, and they'll still withhold their cooldowns, which is the major point for Flipside, is they don't burn anything trying to save the Void. So they can look to go bottom lane. Relax is behind his Mirana, but now they'll join up well within range for a Chronosphere here. However, the Death Prophet is rotating in from the west, and now they may just be able to pincer this Wraith King. They'll drop down an Observer Ward. Relax will try and cover the retreat of the Radiant side, but the Doom gets off onto the Earth Spirit, and that's with the call down all they've expended at this point, still holding the Exorcism and the Chronosphere, and that should allow them to push in this bottom lane. Meanwhile, though, top lane, Beastmaster with his Necro 1 does bring down the Tier 1, and Tame My Wild and Shotslow unable to find anything further in this bottom lane for Flipside. They can sneak into the pit, though, after this Tier 1 is taken down, or even look to pressure a Tier 2 with all their cooldowns still available.
Tame My Wild's going to hold mid lane, but for Beastmaster, he can keep pushing it. Maxed out aura at this stage. No heroes currently incoming. If anyone does, he'll be spotted by the Hawk. They're going to jump in towards the Death Prophet. Siphons are available for the DP, but no, it's too late. Already down. TP is coming in now into a grip immediately. Seedoy's in a lot of trouble. Chronosphere is going to bail him out. Still taking a lot of damage, though, from Focus. He has the Resurrect, so he's not going to die just yet. Seedoy is going to fall to the right clicks of the Bane. Phoenix now going to have to be forced to dive out. Shashlo, same thing. It's a time walk away. They've lost their damage dealer, so Flipside have got to run. Bangscore is going to get caught by a Wraith Fire Blast and the Starstorm as well. Going to spot out for Shashlo. It's actually time walk up to the north, but straight into a Beastmaster who wasn't even involved in that fight. The base void is out of mana, and he's dropped now. Flipside are falling apart and trickling in. It seems like they think that they're invulnerable in these engagements, but yeah. You gotta start that fight as a full five-man squad. Like, throwing in a Chronosphere is nice to help out the Gyro, but if you don't have everything there at the same time, you're not gonna win that fight.
Yeah, and beforehand, the Exorcism taken off the board as well. So, yeah, I think you touched upon it there, just chain feeding, essentially, trickling in one by one, feeling a little bit too tanky on their cores. They don't even have a Yule Scepter to dodge a stun here from Tame My Wild, so they expend no major ultimates whatsoever to force a DP out, and then the defensively natured Chronosphere allows Sedoy to not really contribute all that much to it. Focus still standing on the front lines, right clicking him down. So Flipside certainly overestimating their strength individually here, and it feels like they fed over a lot of their cumulative strength in this early game by just these one-off pickoffs. And they do have perhaps the greedier support duo, but neither of those have seemed to have a major impact just yet in the game, even with their ultimates on the board. So it is going to be relying heavily on these cores who've kind of just trickled in and gone down one by one, forced out big ultimates defensively.
Well, the upside is for Flipside here is that they do have these big ultimates. They're not reliant on a single target, which if the tables were turned, if Flipside were with a single target, they'd be in a much worse position. But since they have all this AoE, all this immediate control with the Doom's ultimate and the Chronosphere, really no matter how far behind they get, they're always going to have at least a shot. They're going to jump in towards the Phoenix, though. Great Fire Blast to land. They're going to magnetize the Phoenix, but that's about it. Stun him up as well with Fangscore. Relax is taking a lot of damage just by the tower. Now the Supernova comes in with a Chronosphere. Relax is just going to burn off to the side, and the Bane will too. He'll Brain Sap, but he'll lose his life afterwards as Broodmothers go in a little bit too deep for the Phoenix without landing that immediate Wraith Fire Blast. Wraith King not really contributing a hell of a lot there. And it will be Flipside to actually get a decent turnaround. Hannah Midas now up on the Phoenix. The Death Prophet in the meantime farms up the rest of her Yule Scepter. Yeah, costs them some ultimates. But again, if you're behind and you have big AoE teamfight ults, you're never out of it.
Yeah, and picking up the Yule Scepter is a big deal as well. It can allow Tame My Wild to actually frontline now effectively. So they'll feel confident enough to go into Roche off the back of a couple of those picks. And BMR very good at scouting this out with both the Earth Spirit and the Mirana, as well as the Beastmaster Hawk. But it is going to drop fairly quickly here with Tame My Wild in the pit. They've got the Ice Armor up on both of these heroes as well, keep them relatively safe. But the Moonlight Shadow, it is going to be popped from the other side. Focus, he's walking into the pit. Sentry's going to scout him, but he gets the Blink off beforehand. The arrow is there as well. Boulder Smash through two. Big Starfall comes down. Aegis of the Immortal picked up, but by Focus's Wraith King, and they get the last hit for the Radiant. Sedoy trying to fight strong. He does in the front lines, but needs to get the heck out of Dodge before Focus respawns. He's got a Blink Dagger on the Wraith King and will jump forward. Gonna get Yulzed up immediately. Sedoy not gonna burn down to the Wraith Fire Blast. He gets bottled up by Tame My Wild. What a play from the Death Prophet. Sedoy may just even survive here. No, Blink forward from Focus looking for that last right click will bring him down. Was a very noble attempt from the DP, but a disaster in the pit for Flipside. They even had a sentry on the ground there, but just were too slow to react to focus walking down and blinking in. So Flipside get punished pretty heavily at the Roche pit, and now they're looking to go in mid lane once again without any other cooldown.
Phoenix kills off the melee warrior and then dies to the ranged one. Oh, geez, that's not the play there for the bird. Wasn't really super healthy to start things out, but the problem there for Flipside was that they had the sentry, yes. They only see the Wraith King, though, and that's not really a hero that, as a Doom, you're happy to cast your ultimate on, and Vangscore was really the only one in a position to cast anything. Now, the Gyrocopter lived for a very long time. That's the reason why Flipside don't get, you know, completely demolished, because they're able to shove the Gyrocopter to the back, the Exorcism from the Death Prophet doing its almost full duration worth of damage to the Broodmother squad, but they don't even get the Roche kill. Like, Broodmother's able to kill off the Roche. They get away with the Aegis, and, yeah, I mean, they eventually do lose that one. Wraith King died a handful of times there, but you know what? That's still going to be a pretty nice win, because now Morana is up to that stage where she's able to just play Broodmother like a Broodmother, not like the Broodmothers. She's got the Aghanim Scepter. Stars are going to be falling, and for the Flipside squad, they have to respect this Morana just by herself now, not to mention the fact that she has Moonlight Shadow and a lot of arrow setup. It's a real dangerous threat that's going to shrink the map very quickly for Flipside, and they really can't afford that right now. Focus also looking at Seedoy over in mid. The arrow, is it coming in? It is, but Seedoy's just going to walk out of that. No big deal. Phoenix is killing himself with that Sunray, but oh, he's not even going to stop it. Okay, so we just committed Sudoku. They're going to kill off the Wraith King, though. Ultimately, kind of worth it. Now, Relax is going to come in. Magnetize a couple. Seedoy also is going to get gripped up. He's going to fall. Doom comes in, which will secure the kill on the Bane. They're also going to Chronosphere Relax. But Flipside, once again, are trickling in. They only have two heroes left, and Mirana's just shredding everyone with the stars. Angscore is going to try to awkwardly get this kill, but I think this is all for naught. He's going to try to get relaxed, ice armor himself. That's not going to do anything. And Flipside throw away absolutely everyone for the Wraith King kill. And up towards top lane, Beastmaster's pushing. This game just might be over.
Yeah, Flipside do not look really fit to fight anymore. And, you know, BM, they're so much less reliant on being together as five. Their pickoff potential is very strong, especially with these two Blink Daggers now on the Earth Spirit and the Wraith King. And Flipside, they really rely on hitting their ultimates in combination with one another, and that has just starved them out in terms of experience and net worth gain. Look at the top three levels in the game. The tri-core of BM holds that. The top three net worth contenders are also the tri-core of BM, and you know, maybe the Doom is a bit ahead of your Bane as you had a greedy support duo, but Flipside, They don't feel like they're communicating very well as a squad right now. Ultimates are being expended when other heroes are not nearby. You know, Chronospheres are being used in a defensive nature to save cores over and over again. And for that reason, they're not hitting the enemy cores. They're simply hitting whoever is in the front line at the given time. That last one we saw only connected on an Earth Spirit. And as you mentioned, the Mirana continues to go to town. You're just kind of ignored. So Blink Dagger I mentioned on the Wraith King and the Earth Spirit. Bane now has one. Mirana now has one. Flipside, they're going to feel like their counter-initiation potential is much less potent with all these Blinks available.
What have we here?
It is just like a Flipside's players, I think, is the issue. Like, they have still the heroes and an okay amount of farm, enough so that, in theory, if they were to, like, refresh their minds, they will be able to still win this game. And it just takes a couple of wins to get them back into it, but the way they're playing right now, they cannot win. They really have to switch something up. They're going to smoke right into each other. Silence onto two, going to open things up, but Relax, that's a massive stun off onto everyone. They're going to lose two immediately with no ultimates being cast. Now the supernova's there, but that's going to be cracked through immediately as well. Four kills as Broodmothers, specifically this Earth Spirit, able to halt that Flipside advance in its tracks, losing four heroes for nothing. They got a supernova off, but everything else, like, that was them dead before they could even react.
Yeah, unfortunate timing for the smoke to pop there, and a great reaction as well, just coming out from Relax's Earth Spirit. So huge four-man grip, I believe he got off in that one, and no one really able to do anything from Flipside. They do still hold all their ultimates, so the high ground defense is possible, but with the Inner Beast aura, this push is going to come real quickly from BM side. Looks like they're just going to chip for the time being. They have these Blink Daggers available, so they're pretty safe to do so. The Hawk as well, scouting out the high ground, just expired here. So flip side, they're just bleeding heroes at this point. Doesn't feel like they're really playing cohesively as a unit, and BM will take the lower hanging fruit in the bottom lane of this last outer tier tower. They've got ill positioned up on the cliff with the hawk, so they can disengage fairly cleanly. Everyone pretty low, but they'll take their spoils and be more than content with it.
Sean, not an option for them just yet, but dominating the map is. They have a gem and, of course, the Necrobooks on the Beastmaster, and they have a Moonlight Shadow in just a couple more seconds as well. As Flipside lose more and more fights, it's going to be obviously harder for them to win that one fight that they really need. But if they are going to win a fight, it's going to be the high ground fight when Broodmothers will typically tend to clump up a little bit more. So a massive Chronosphere, Sun combo, you know, who knows what's going to happen. The Courier, oh, it's going to be picked off by a Boar. And a Boar and a Hawk for the Vision. That's it. So Flipside can't even get that. Not sure who was sending that Courier out, but seems like it might have been the Gyrocopter. I don't know.
It may
either
have been
way, still not good times here for the Flipside squad, as they can't get anything out. They can't even leave their base. Like, this entire area, Secret Shop area, is just one big dead zone. Speaking of dead zone, Phoenix is going to die here.
Yeah, top lane, they are stalking the Mirana. And they will get the silence off, but can they get in range in time? They will get the Chronosphere here, and that's a pretty big kill for Flipside to delay the push out. But they do use the Chronosphere for it. So, Wraith King's got two lives. They'll jump up to the high ground. They still have or they actually expended the Roar for the Phoenix. So they do not have the Roar available, but they still have the grip to at least look to disengage if the Prophet pops up her Exorcism. And there's no control left, so they'll get a pretty significant amount of chip damage done on this tier 3. The Boulder Smash will cover the retreat. And BM, despite losing, you know, their Mirana, that being suboptimal, are going to get a Phoenix kill and a little bit of damage on this tier 3. Going to be content to continue farming away as well. So Flipside, they do make a good maneuver, and felt like that Courier kill to some extent was a blessing in disguise, as the Beastmaster with Necro 3 Blink Roar available was stalking, just waiting for them to inch down forward. But either way, Flipside still heavily on the back foot in this.
For the Broodmother side, yeah, they're going to probably back off from this area. Let Flipside get back onto the map, and that's just good for Broodmothers. They have so much pick-off power that they're going to probably catch up to someone outside the base, and if it's Faceless Void, they're going to be very happy about that. And well, then taking out that one big ultimate, regardless of who it is, really all the ultimates matter a lot for Flipside. That is what's going to let them push up the high ground, and we'll see who's actually able to find that first. Because the Broodmother side are still farming quite quickly. Focus even getting that Maelstrom to farm even more, with even more speed. Of course, just, you know, getting to the enemy base faster as a Wraith King. Double Stars instantly kills off a wave for the Mirana and Beastmaster. Maybe not the fastest compared to his companions, is still going to be enough to pressure just by himself. So it's just going to be a matter of time, I feel, for Flipside get someone picked off here. And if it's Void, then it's just, you know, Rax is over. But what they have to do is try to, like, play the pickoff game a little bit better. And looking at the ward coverage for the Broodmother squad, it's looking difficult for Flipside to make that happen.
Yeah, and just all the mobility from their lineup as well. Four Blink Daggers and an Earth Spirit available to them. Earth Spirit sitting on 2100 gold. Can maybe pick up a Veil to buff up the Mirana's damage here very soon. Mirana, speaking of which, does have a Lincoln Sphere up as well. So nice to be had against the Doom, and there's really nothing else to pop it here aside from the Spirit Siphon. So more than often than not, can be there to at least soak up the Dooms for a little bit. Have free reign in these fights, continue to get these Starfalls off every 8 seconds. So BM have what they need to go high ground. Fresh BKB as well on the Wraith King. And, you know, they'll assemble up with Ill here, look to engage onto someone who's jumping forward, and Flipside may just bring the fight to them. Up on the high ground, Arrow's going to connect onto the Phoenix. Ill will blink out as he expects the entire lineup of Flipside to be nearby. But that will thwart the smoke attempt, the essentially desperation smoke attempt coming out from Flipside.
Not sure if that was the plan to stop the smoke, but man, it sure as hell works. There's also Observer Ward still in range here for Broodmothers. They can even illuminate more map vision from Flipside squad. A smoke play is like the play that they have to make, and the unfortunate circumstances of that one not really going to help them out. You really have to catch someone off guard without them being in ward vision Broodmother. They're going to get that kill because everyone and their mom is a Blink Dagger. And soon they're going to have a couple more lives, most likely for the Mirana. Zorshan is going to be cleaned out very quickly. Vamp Aura is going to make it safe. And they will have that now ready to maybe brute force the high ground. Killing off Mirana and Wraith King, it's important, but you got to do it twice for both of them. With the BKB on the Wraith King as well still being at 10 seconds. So for Flipside, they need a miracle fight at this stage if they want to stay in it.
Yeah, it is going to require all their ultimates to land in tandem, and you know, it's definitely a scary combination and something that BM have respected. They haven't forced the high ground overly aggressively. They do have this top lane exposed, and that's why you'll see Shotzil look to push this out before he TPs back to base. But either way, with the recent item pickups we've been describing, it definitely feels like Broodmother's now with the Aegis is as good a time as any to look to crack base.
We're gonna go towards top lane. It's the one where range axes are pretty much dead already, so you might as well go there. Mm-hmm. And of course, there's no 2-3, so there's less detection to worry about. Should you want to Moonlight Shadow, they're gonna see the Wraith King still be in range of the Chronosphere. They're gonna drop it on him. He is all alone, so if they can bring him down twice, maybe they'll be able to defend their base afterwards. BKB's not gonna be top for his first life. He's gonna put up Blade Mail though. That's gonna be killed off. Top lane though is pushing. And for Ill and his squad, they'll take down one set of Raxes, melee Raxes soon after. Should be brought down. The rest of the team trying to kill off the Wraith King again. He's gonna pop his BKB and just try to book it. Still alive for right now. He's gonna get the do on to relax. The Tame My Wild's going wild with his ultimate. He's gonna drive everyone back. Thanks for it though. He's gonna take an arrow and will fall. The Wraith King is somehow still alive. How is he still alive? The missile's gonna chase after him. Is there any true sign here? There's not. There's only the missile, and he's gonna blink out. They don't even kill him off. And the Raxes will be taken out toward top lane. Tame My Wild running out of ultimate. Now he's gonna get gripped. His return of his ultimate is not gonna come in time. They lose the Raxes, don't even get the Wraith King. And Flipside are now a Rax down. And really down a really big opportunity as well. They'll try to drive away the Mirana, but no true sight. Moonlight Shadow has trounced Flipside this entire game.
Yeah, they get the Sentry down, but it's a bit late onto the Wraith King there, mid lane. And, you know, had they had that preemptively, as you mentioned, should have been able to at the very least bring him down. Not sure if they would have mounted a defense top lane, but they lose the Rax either way, and just not a convenient position to find him out. They saw the Mirana top lane, but perhaps weren't sure that everyone else was with her, and saw a good situation to take out a Wraith King. So it seems like just, you know, delaying the inevitable for Flipside at this point. They still do have this Aegis available. Call down will come through and focus, take a good amount of damage from it, but he's still got this 9-second BKB charge available. He's got a reincarnation if need be, and they do know that the exorcism is currently off the board, so that's the reason you see Broodmothers just stick around a little bit there for some residual damage on the mid lane.
Take the Rax's top, which of course means bottom lane is all the more attractive now for the Broodmothers team. That still wasn't really that big team fight that Flipside are looking for. It's the Broodmothers able to spread out the Flipside crew and keep the fights on a small scale. We don't know exactly how powerful Flipside are in a massive team exchange, but I don't think it's going to be favorable for them, especially if Tame My Wild is going to start this fight by getting silenced and stunned. That's the silence for right now. No grip for another couple seconds there for the Bane. Now he has it, but it's a little bit too late. If they got a grip there straight off on the Death Prophet, that might have just been game.
Mm. It definitely would have been another lane, at the very least. Even if she buys back there, it's such a detriment, and does have it available. They are going to go in for the mid lane. Lincoln Sphere is going to be at the very least revealed here. Not sure if they had used it last fight, as last fight wasn't necessarily a full-scale engagement just in that top lane with only a couple heroes coming back to defend. So Shiva's going to be completed up as well, which is nice into the Chronosphere if they're able to drop it and the Mirana is outside of it. But they'll just throw the Battering Ram, the Siege Engine, and the Wraith King up on the high ground. He's got the BKB. He's got the second life. He has the Blade Mail as well. So just there to bring down the tower. Now they'll jump forward with the Shiva's Guard. Focus, get a man up on Sadoi. He BKBs and it's a bit late. They do get a nice Chronosphere off with a Supernova on top. But the Mirana, she's got the Aegis and she's still not going down. Shotzil, he's going to end up dropping. The Supernova will pop onto 3. And Focus is doomed up, but does have the BKB up, not taking all that much damage. Vanskor's going to die to the Brain Sap as the Mirana's Aegis goes down. Now Tame My Wild, he should drop here momentarily as well. The Phoenix going to go down as the Mirana respawns with the Starfall. Shotzil going to buy back. Death Prophet has a buyback as well. Does not have an exorcism though. This is going to be the second lane of Rax, or at least the melee Rax, going down here. Focus is going to be backed out on the Wraith King. Does have the ability to blink and re-engage if someone oversteps their boundaries. And now a jump forward with the Shivas is going to force out Flipside with the Inner Beast Aura. They're going to be able to take down this Range Rat extremely quickly. And Vanskor, he will throw in the towel for Flipside. Broodmothers, after a good looking early start and basically one team fight to lose them game two, will pretty much gain the advantage throughout this entire game, except for in the bottom lane where Shachlo got too much. But they were able to just weather the storm of the Chronosphere and able to take engagements with numbers constantly. It seemed like Flipside were just really poor at reinforcing in this one, and they kind of just chain fed for the most part in the early mid game, where Broodmothers take an advantage, roll with it safely, take high ground, make sure they have an Aegis each time, and only look for, you know, very appealing opportunities to push.
So I'd have to play as a team, and that's just
yeah
what they didn't do, always trickling in, and that will kill you off with any lineup really, let alone one with so many AoE ultimates.
So game two going to be in the books, guys. We're going to go to a decider, game three, in this last game of the semifinals for the Game On Dota 2 Invitational. Winner going to move on to face Pro Dota Gaming in the grand final. So MRP, Mike Loris, your English coverage. We'll be back for the final game of the day shortly.